talk right now. So the talk is approach to lens in ocular trauma. So see, lens injury is much more common than one would presume, and outcome is generally much poorer due to the associated injuries rather than the lens itself. So if you look at these pictures over here, you've got a contusion, a rupture, a penetrating injury, an intraocular foreign body, a perforating injury, and all of these, most of these have associated with a cataract or some sort of a lens damage. In the same way, if you see at these posterior segment damage that has taken place in trauma, if all these things, endophthalmitis, vitreous hemorrhage, retinal detachment, you always see that there is some sort of lens damage is also sometimes present. Several issues related to the management of lens, sorry, are controversial though. So it's very, very important that when you do start with the lens, a preoperative assessment is extremely important in all trauma cases. It's critical. So the size of the tear, whether the lens is involved or not, sometimes you have to see in retroillumination also, that gives a better idea if there whether is there any vitreous prolapse or not, whether there's an if there's an uneven AC depth, that could sometimes be the only sign of slight subluxation of the lens. A B scan is controversial, and I generally do not prefer to do it in case of open globe injuries. However, if sometimes, very rarely, we go for a B scan, particularly when we are looking for an intraocular foreign body. And you have to also be careful, it has to be very gentle, as Dr. Avnish has said. A CT scan, again, would be advised, as Dr. Nupur and Dr. Avnish has said, that to look for these intraocular foreign bodies. So there is always a disparity between the preoperative and the intraoperative findings. So when you're doing the surgery, if there's any vitreous, inject triamcinolone acetonide, and confirm its presence. That's the first thing that you do in case if there's a vitreous, even if it's a subluxated lens also. First, inject triamcinolone, do the vitrectomy, and then you can proceed for your surgery. So if you look at this is from the HAIR database again. So if there's an anterior capsular breach, most of the times, intraoperatively also you find that. But if it's a posterior capsular breach, you're saying that definitely there's a posterior capsular breach 23 times, but intraoperatively was 45 times, according to their study. So much 2 times more, you can say that, sometimes you don't even know that the posterior capsule is intact or whether it is damaged. So a capsular breach could be anterior, where you have to see it on a slit lamp, and good dilatation is necessary if the lesion is peripheral. If it's a posterior lesion, sometimes more difficult to visualize and can also occur in isolation without the involvement of the anterior capsule. We have to look, if there's a capsular breach, look for an intraocular foreign body and be prepared for intraoperative surprises. Sometimes just for the capsular breach, no treatment is required. So let's look at this surgery over here. So this was a corneal tear with a cataract that this patient presented with. Since it was a very small tear, so you can see any tear, what you have to do is strain with Trifan Blue, and you can see the capsule edges nicely. And then once that's lineated, you can repair the corneal tear. Only one suture was required. And then this thing has been converted. This tear, anterior capsular tear, has been converted into a rexus somewhat. And then you can do IA, irrigation aspiration. And these are very soft lenses, these are traumatic lenses. And just IA is sometimes enough. If you don't have access as residents to this bimanual IA, what you can do is you can sometimes, you can start using, you can even use a Simco cannula. See, but sometimes, you're doing surgery very fast and nothing happens, and you're, but look at there. There's something wrong over here. So if you look at it in slow motion over here, what has happened is once I've removed that, you can see this round thing over here. So this is posterior capsular rent, and this was present before it itself. So always you have to expect that there could be a posterior capsular breach. So what I'm doing over here after this breach is there is I'm injecting OVD or HPMC or visco from one side to push the vitreous down, and this is a vitrectomy cutter which I'm using to do the vitrectomy. So at the same time, I'm tamponading the vitreous so that it doesn't come forward, and using this cutter, I'm doing a vitrectomy. Once this is done, this vitrectomy is done, there's no vitreous in the anterior chamber, and then I can easily implant a 3-piece foldable intraocular lens into the sulcus. So this is what it looked like. This patient did very well. This is a video from my fellowship days as well. So this is how it was. So at the end of surgery. So this is another video. This is not my video. This is courtesy Dr. Deepak Magur, who produces fantastic videos, and you should definitely have a look at his YouTube channel. So this is what he had described in the video. Thank you, sir, for allowing me to use this video of his. So this is a corneal tear over here. There's an intracorneal foreign body along with and this foreign body has extended into the anterior chamber. Along with it, there is a lens perforation and you can see a cataract over here. So this is a quite challenging situation and you have to plan accordingly. So incision could be a temporal incision or could be a 12 o'clock or a superior incision. However, this foreign body is longitudinal, it's long. It will be very difficult for me to take it out via the temporal incision. So therefore, Dr. Magoor has done a 12 o'clock incision over here, which makes it easy to remove the foreign body as well as do the tear. So let's take a look at this video. So he's injected OVD after making a side port. Once that is done, he's formed a scleral tunnel. And this next step is to remove this foreign body, which is in the cornea and the anterior chamber. Look at the size of this huge metallic foreign body. So once this is done, so what he has done over here is he's sutured this tear and meticulous suturing was done, followed by he started doing an irrigation aspiration. So irrigation aspiration was done and this entire lens matter was removed. So after this, you can see this is the anterior capsule tear that was here. And what he has done is he's converted into a somewhat CCC and he's put this three-piece IOL into the sulcus with an optic capture, meaning that the haptics are in the sulcus and then optic is in the bag. And after this, it's important to always inject triamcinolone and check for any vitreous. So if there are fragments in the anterior chamber, so lens pieces, they are a major cause of inflammation and raised IOP. And all of these particles, it is imperative to remove them because they induce an intense anti-inflammatory reaction. So lens particles plus vitreous plus blood in the anterior chamber is a potential inciter of PVR development, as Dr. Avanish said. So coming to the cataract, which is the most common lens injury, it causes significant visual disturbance. It can be localized to total, and the progression can be from a minor injury to a total cataract in about hours to years. Swelling is there with increased IOP, and it's generally soft, as I had mentioned. So aspiration itself is enough to take it out. So intervention in such cases is influenced by what is happening in the posterior segment. This is another case. So this is another case of mine, which I had done during my So this was a corneal tear. This capsule was then taken out and I'm trying to cut it with the Varna scissor. No, somewhat I managed it and then I'm then, irrigating this cortex so that it could come out. Finding it very difficult over here using a bimanual IA. So what I find over here is a plaque. Now it's very important to remove this plaque because this plaque is present in the visual axis. So some OVD is injected underneath this plaque, to create a plane. After this is done, I use a Varna scissor. You can also use a micro scissors, and give a cut at this. And then after injecting again more OVD in the anterior chamber and then behind this area as well, I go in with the Rexis forceps. You can also use a micro Rexis forceps. And I'm trying to peel this off. Now this peeling would be something like a Rexis that you would do in a cataract surgery. See, I'm very scared right now because I can easily damage the PC and it can be result in a disaster. Look at the size of this plaque. It's thick. And I'm relieved right now that nothing has happened and I'm happy. So once this is done, then my next step is to remove this iris or the repositor. It is adherent to the back of the cornea. So I have to be very gentle because it can easily cause an iridodialysis. So since that part was not coming out, I'm going to cut it with the Varna scissors. So this is done. I didn't do this earlier on because this acted as an iris hook for me. And you can use, I was getting a good view. And this was followed by implantation of a three-piece foldable IOL into the sulcus. This is a video from 2016. After this, all the visco that was there inside the anterior chamber was removed.
some air was injected, the main tunnel or the main incision was sutured, and these loose sutures were removed. Now these sutures have to ideally be removed at 3 months post surgery, but when they are loose, you have to always remove them. That is the thing, because it can result in suture infiltrate, which can be a problematic situation. This is what it looked like at the end of the surgery, and this patient did very well. So this is another patient I operated about this month only, or last month. So this was a child, okay? And this child had a traumatic cataract. We had done the tear and it had healed. And so I'm making the two incisions over here. The side port incisions with an MBR knife, followed by a clear corneal incision using a 2.8 keratome. Again, see, I'm staining the whatever lens matter is there, and then I get a good idea of how the anterior capsule is, whether it is breached or not. So some OVD is injected into the anterior chamber. So my next step is to remove this fluffy part of the lens that is actually there. So I remove this, and you see, it's so soft, it's just coming on like that. So once this is done, see, again and again, I'm injecting visco inside. So then I'm going to convert this anterior capsule part into a rexus. This is a, so I go in with my Haldiprukkar forceps that I use a lot. So I'm trying to do a rexus over here. Now, pediatric eyes behave very differently to the adult eyes. So you can't take it to the outside. You have to push it, you have to, sorry, pull it towards the center. Otherwise, it's going to result in an extension. So this is a difference when you do rexus in a pediatric eye in comparison to an adult eye. So see, I'm trying to do the rexus. It's a very, very slow maneuver that you do over here. Again and again, injecting visco inside the anterior chamber and, you know, getting this done. So this part is fibrotic and it's not coming out. So then I'm going to inject some more OVD inside, and then I'm going to go with my micro scissors and cut this. So then this is brought out of the eye, this loose thing. So then after that, what I do is I go in with my bimanual irrigation aspiration. You can also use a Simcoe cannula over here and see the lens matter is so easily removed from the eye. So I'll skip this part. So once this is done, there is some synechia that is developed over here, some fibrotic part. So I'm trying to release that. And then you see over here, there's another plaque. So then again, I'm going to peel it off with my microdexis forceps, Haldiprukkar type. And you know, then I get a clear view over there. This is also quite thick, and these are very common post-trauma, particularly in children. So you'll have to peel them, and if they're not peeling, you have to do, you take them out via a cutter. Some more OVD is injected inside, and then, you know, washing is done, and then followed by the implantation of a three-piece foldable lens into the bag. So far so good, no issues. I'm very happy with the surgery so far. Okay, so then I'm going to dilate now. And it's in the back. So after this is done, the surgery doesn't get over because it's a child. Now then you have to do a primary posterior capsulotomy or a rexus. So this is a vitrectomy probe cutter that I am using. And I'm going behind now. I'm behind the IOL and I'm making a cut in the PC because this is a very four-year-old child. And you know, otherwise if PCOs are very common and very thick in them and they develop very fast. So he will not cooperate for a YAC capsulotomy later. So I have to do this and, you know, clear the visual axis. So I'm trying to do, it's a very slow process and I'm working on it. So this is, you can see over here. If you see over here, this is my PPC that is developing, that I'm forming over here. So you can see over here, this is the PPC that I'm trying to show you. So this is this very small PPC. You have to enlarge it because, you know, you have to have an area that will allow also for retinal evaluation. So once this is done, then I'm going to, I'm increasing my size of PPC. And, you know, this is a very long process, this vitrectomy that I'm doing. Sometimes vitreous does come, so you have to do minimal vitrectomy. So you see over here, this is the PPC that I have attained. This is my size of PPC that I have made. So injecting some more OVD Now I'm again dialing the lens because it had come into the sulcus. I'm going to go put it into the position inside the back. And it's nice, it's stable. So this is the outer rim is, if you look at this, this outer rim is the opening that I would want for the anterior capsule rexus, and the inner one is the size that I would want for a PPC. This is done, followed by suturing. All pediatric surgeries have to be sutured. All the wounds have to be sutured. I've done that, injected tricot. There is a little bit of vitreous, I guess, and then I did vitrectomy for that. I removed it. Again, I am suturing the wounds. No issues at all. Closed. So this is what it looked like at the end of the surgery. Happy surgery. But look at this. There was a surprise on POD1. The iris, the haptic is, coming onto the iris over here. So then I have to again take this patient up. So look at the orientation over here. So I go in again. And what I'm doing over here is I'm rotating this IOL into position. So again, I'm putting this into the bag. Once I have done this, it doesn't stop here because the anterior capsule is deficient in this part. So this is going to again and again come, and this is going to create a problem. So then my next step is, what I'm thinking, what I should do next is then I'm going with my dialer and I'm checking every here now, inspecting the anterior capsule, how is the rim? And what I do is I'm putting the lens now behind the PC or the posterior capsule. So my optic is behind the posterior capsule and my haptics are in the somewhat bag that is there. So it's going to fix that position. This is called a posterior capture. So this, there's some synechia. See, in one day, this synechia had developed. I released it to this repositor. And then what I did is then I'm removing the OVD. There's no vitreous. The surgery looks good. And this is how it looked at the end of the surgery. This patient had a vision of 624 unaided at the end of surgery. So this is another case that I would show. This is another case that I've done about last month. This is a cell sealed corneal tear this patient presented with. And so I'm making my incision. See, again, I'm staining the anterior capsule over here. This anterior capsule is stained. And so you can see that there's a lot of breaks within the capsule, making my incisions. So this is the tear that is here. So I'm going to make it opposite to that, because I don't want my main incision to be near this wound. So then I'm removing a little bit of this fluffy area of this swollen lens. And once that is done, I'm going to move on to my next step is look at this. So once this is done, I noticed that, there's something inside. I've injected OVD, but I noticed something is there. And look at this. There's a foreign body inside, a transparent foreign body, which was not there earlier on. So this was missed in slit lamp and even in the initial surgery that I had done. So the IE is continued after this, breaking all the synechia that are there. Once that is done, then I'm again cutting this anterior capsule of this lens. And again, using my Haldipurkar forceps, I'm converting it into a rexus. So again, see this, there's a fibrotic area over here. So then I have to use my micro scissors and cut that part out. Once that is done, then now removing the lens, rest of the lens is a piece of cake. And aspiration is done and this lens comes out pretty easily. Now, since this is an adult eye, I will not be doing a primary posterior capsule rexus or a capsulotomy. You can use a vitrectomy cutter for that, or you can also use a rexus forceps, whatever you're comfortable with. Changing my hands, and this part was all removed. Then some PC polishing. And after that, this was followed by the implantation of this foldable lens into the bag. So this, so far so good, surgery done. It's in the bag. And I'm extremely happy with the result. Okay, this is what it looked like at the end of the surgery. But again, surprise, surprise. On POD1, I find that this lens is also decentered. So you have to be, these lenses don't behave like normal cataractous lenses because the support system is damaged. So then I again redial this. lens. You have to be very gentle in these maneuvers. And then this lens was put into place. The IA was done. And this is what this eye looked like at the end of surgery. This patient had a vision of about 618 or 612 unaided on POD1 after the POD2 now. So the goal when you're dealing with lens over here is to, in trauma, is that the aim is not the lens, to preserve the lens. The aim is to prevent the iatrogenic damage to the retina. You have to sometimes even sacrifice the lens if, and preserving the capsule further will increase the risk of anterior PVR and thysis also. So next part is whether to do a when you're doing a primary versus secondary cataract extraction, whether to put the IOL or not. So primary, when you do it as a single surgery, it helps in the prevention of secondary complications, mainly the IOP elevation it causes. And it also, there is advantage is that it results in, you know, immediate visual rehabilitation, and also the post-operative synechia that formed later, later on. So if you do an IOL right now, it's minimized. However, there's always increased inflammation in these eyes. Secondaries, you can choose the optimal IOL power. You can even put a toric IOL to manage the astigmatism. So therefore, generally secondaries are recommended. So primary generally is done when a child is there or a patient is poor, he cannot come again, and or compliance is very poor from the patient. Secondaries are the ones that are recommended because there is less inflammation in that eye and you can tackle the astigmatism part. Now, how do you calculate? However, this is controversial. So it depends on surgeon to surgeon and case to case. How do you calculate the power in such cases? So biometry, sometimes there's a lot of corneal scarring. So you cannot take the keratometry reading from that eye. You can take it from the other eye, the normal eye. And generally I use an SRKT formula for these cases and it does well. Which IOL to implant, whether a single piece IOL or a multi-piece IOL? Generally, multi-piece IOL or a three-piece IOL is preferred. However, if the capsule, anterior and the posterior capsule are very nice and intact and doing very well, then you can also implant a single piece IOL, but mostly implant a multi-piece IOL. So post-operatively, you have to control the inflammation, evaluate the retina, do a suture management, as I said, 3 months. After that, you start removing sutures. However, before, if you have any loose sutures, you have to remove them. Then visual rehabilitation is very important post the surgeries. And you know, after this, all the sutures are done, everything is done, the cataract has also been done, then sometimes for the scarring, you can give a RGP lenses. For children, once the traumatic cataract has been taken out, after the 7th day, you have to give them glasses, particularly if they are very young. So, you know, because to prevent amblyopia, sometimes patching therapy has to also be given. So in children, you have to act fast. You can't wait for a month or something, you know, then I'm going to do, because amblyopia is rapid in these children. So to summarize, I would say that a small tear with cataract can be taken up for a primary combined surgery, that is a tear repair plus cataract extraction plus IOL. If there are lens fragments in the anterior chamber, you have to remove them. If there's an anterior capsular tear, management remains controversial. A secondary IOL is recommended, and the goal is to prevent damage to the retina. Early amblyopia management is critical in children. So the difficult roads, I would say, lead to beautiful destinations. So, no, initially you'll be finding it difficult, but eventually you'll get there. Thank you so much.